True, but that was what he promised. And it sort of looks similar to the honest majority assumption that we have in the MPC literature, right? So definitely there is some connection, although Satoshi seemed to be sort of unaware, or at least he didn't cite any of these MPC papers in his work. Well, so what is the main design principle of Bitcoin? There is no time to introduce Bitcoin during this short talk, but well, let's just say what is the basic idea. The basic idea is that, well, the users jointly emulate trusted bulletin board, okay? They call it ledger or blockchain, on which they post transactions. So this bulletin board consists a list of transactions, and it's right on the bulletin board, so transactions cannot be erased, and this is a way to prevent double spending. Okay, so what is the main difference when you look at it between the MPCs and the Bitcoin? So in the MPCs, we always define the majority of parties in terms of the number of parties, right? In Bitcoin, we have the majority of computing power. Okay? So there's obviously some difference, and it is there for a good reason. So well, the problem that Satoshi faced is how to define majority in the situation where everybody can join the network. Okay, so Bitcoin is a system that works on the internet. Everybody can join the system. There is no way to verify identity. So, well, if you have a situation like this, so you have like three honest guys and one dishonest guy, then nothing prevents this dishonest guy from creating lots of fake identities and gaining the majority, right? So defining security in terms of the number of participants in a situation where everybody can join a network and create as many identities as he wants makes little sense. And that's called Sybil attack sometimes in the practitioner's literature. Well, in contrast, if the majority is defined in terms of computing power, then creating multiple identities doesn't help, right? Why? Because, well, if you have this bad guy here, this is always bad, this green guy here. So even if he creates many copies of himself, he just has still the same computing power. Right? So that's the main idea of defining majority in Bitcoin. And well, the question is how the computing power is verified. So Satoshi uses something that's called proof of work that was introduced by Dworkin now a long time ago. So what is the proof of work? Proof of work, well, it's an interactive protocol where like prover receives some challenge and computes a solution. We will denote this proof of work with POW. This is a solution S on computed on the challenge. He outputs S, and then everybody can verify that he computed this challenge by applying some function verify. And moreover, computing this function POW should take some time. So this is how security is defined. To produce such a proof of work, one needs to work time at least T. Okay? Where this T is defined in terms of the number of calls to some random oracle. This proof of work usually contains some hash function, so we can just measure, and this computing the hash function is a dominating factor. So you can just measure the number of times you call the random oracle. And in Bitcoin, what is meant by this is the Bitcoin proof of work have this property that it's an expected time T. Okay? So if you are lucky, you can solve it faster. If you are unlucky, maybe you need to wait to work more. What we use in our paper, we use proof of work that you need to always work time at least T. We construct them using Merkle trees. It's pretty straightforward and I think standard construction. And I will not go into details of this. So for a moment, until the end of this talk, let's just remember the proof of work for us is something that takes time to compute always. Okay. So how is this bulletin board implemented in Bitcoin? So that's what's called the blockchain. The users, well, probably most of you have already seen it, so I will just show it quickly. So the users maintain a chain of blocks, and each block contains, like depends on the previous block. It's like a hash of the previous block, and the messages from the last period. Or transactions from the last period, and extending this block chain is moderately hard. So this is where the POWs are used. It should take around 10 minutes. And it all started with the Genesis block created by Satoshi in the January 3rd, 2009. It's called the blockchain. Okay, so there was the Genesis block, and since January 2009, people are working on extending this blockchain. So what are the problems with Bitcoin's solution? Because it sort of looks like could be used for, looks almost like a broadcast channel. So there's one serious problem discovered by Eyal and Cedar a year ago. So they showed that basically they showed that the claim made by Satoshi in his paper is not true, and there is a strategy where a malicious minority, or minority in sense of computing power, can actually benefit from not following the protocol. It's called selfish mining, and it's a very interesting paper. Well, it sounds nice. It comes from the fact that there was no proof in Satoshi's paper. Right? I think if he tried to prove that his protocol is secure, then probably he would see this problem. But nobody tried to prove it, and it turned out it's actually not true. So I think it's yet again an argument why proofs actually sometimes are good. So the second thing is the genesis block, from which this blockchain started. It had to be generated in a trusted way. Okay, so Bitcoin security relied on the unpredictability of this block zero before the 3rd of January 2009. Well, in some sense, now, after so much work was done on this blockchain, it's very unlikely that actually Satoshi was secretly mining, for example, 10 years earlier, the same blockchain. So this is not that much worry from practical point of view, but at least from theoretical point of view, it doesn't look good. That there is, well, it should be currency that is not based on any trust assumptions, and in fact, it is based on the assumption that initial block was generated randomly. And it's not really exactly the same as CRS because it really had to be unpredictable. Okay? If Satoshi knew it like a month earlier, he could have started mining 1 month earlier. Okay? So what it has to be something that can be called unpredictable beacon. So it's a, we would need a procedure for producing a value B, some string B, such that no adversary can predict the value B of B before the procedure started. Okay? And we can even allow the adversary to partly influence this value of B, but as long as he cannot make it equal to some value that he chooses. Okay. So something like this would be needed to make this, to get rid of this assumption that this block zero was genesis block was generated honestly. Where Satoshi had some heuristic solution for it. So what he did is he hashed the title of a front page of London Times from the 3rd of January 2009. So this is the title that he hashed, and yeah. It's sort of a nice heuristic. Other ideas, you could use stock market data, astronomical observations, NIST randomness beacon, or you could use actually for new currencies, you could use Bitcoin blockchain itself as an unpredictable beacon. Well, all these ideas have some problems, and in particular, it's hard to automatize them. If you would like to use blockchain for some other purposes, then well, we cannot have like always look at some newspapers and rely on the fact that their titles are unpredictable, right? Because it all kind of reduces our trust to trusting the newspapers. Right? So, natural idea is to start from scratch and ask if we can construct in this Bitcoin model, if you can construct protocols like distributed cryptography protocols that are provably secure. Okay? So we don't have this like hand-waving arguments that Satoshi made. And do not require any trusted setup. Okay. So without this genesis block. The motivation is, well, maybe we can improve the existing currencies or propose new cryptocurrencies with better properties, with better understanding of their security. Another interesting motivation is that actually this POW-based consensus is used for other purposes now, not only financial. Okay, so maybe people can use some of this technology for some other non-financial purposes. Well, here's a list of some citations. Okay, so what is the Bitcoin network model when you start formalizing these things? So, well, there is no authentication and secrecy, okay, so everything happens publicly. There is no secure broadcast channel, but, well, we guarantee that every message sent by an honest user arrives to every other user within some time delta. Okay, so it is a synchronous network in the sense that there is some time delta within which every message arrives. It sort of looks like it's needed because we will be measuring computing effort in terms of like how many hashes you can compute per second. So then we need some notion of time. Mm-hmm. Okay, so every message arrives. It will be also called insecure broadcast. Okay, so it's just like broadcast, meaning that I send message to everyone, but of course, if I'm dishonest, I can send different messages to different people. Okay, so how do we model the computing power? We use the random oracle model. We have a H is a hash function that's modeled as a random oracle. And the computing power of a party P is defined, and this is also a term from Bitcoin. It's called hash rate. So hash rate of a party is the number of times a party P can call H in some given time delta. Okay, okay, and then we will, this is a notation. So we will assume that every we have some group of participants. We have some. We will have some adversary in a moment. So we have some participants. Every participant, honest participant, has some hash rate denoted pi. Okay. So for simplicity, let's assume that everybody who is honest has the same hash rate, and the adversary has hash rate pi sub a. And additional assumptions are that, well, the parties need to know where the, when this game starts, okay? And there's some unique session ID that they agree in advance, and the hash rate of the honest parties is known to everyone, and there is an upper bound on the total hash rate in the system, okay? So it's like L times P, so L is like how many times more there can be total computing power than what a typical honest guy has. And this parameter is known to everyone. Okay, so what are the results? So we show that in case each honest party controls a non-negligible fraction of the hash rate, so this pi is a non-negligible fraction of L times pi. So L is non-negligible. So it can be like the adversary controls the majority of computing power, but this guy still computes some noticeable fraction. We construct a PoW-based broadcast protocol, and I will tell you in a moment what it is. We construct a protocol for unpredictable beacon generation, and they work in time linear in L. And well, in case the adversary controls the minority of the hash rate, we construct a protocol for identifying a group of users with honest majority, a group with honest majority. Okay, so we'll have a protocol that creates a PKI, a public key infrastructure, such that we will know that the majority of public keys is controlled by honest users, and hence we can do any MPC in this case. Because then we can just use known results. Okay, so what is our main tool? Our main tool is this POW-based secure broadcast protocol, and has the following properties. Okay, so it has like standard properties like validity, that every message arrives to always arrives to everybody, consistency, that everybody gets the same message, and well, that's not standard. The last property says that the adversary can send a bounded number of messages. Okay? So what we mean by this is we assume that, well, it all happens at once. So everybody is broadcasting something, and the adversary cannot send more messages than his fraction of the hash rate. Okay, so if he, so this is pi sub a is his hash rate, and pi is a hash rate of honest guys. Okay, so just look at how many times stronger he is than a typical honest guy, and this is the number of messages that he can send, okay? Which is anyway something that obviously he can always make, right? Because he can always just pretend he's honest and send, and simulate this honest guys. Okay, so if you have like this is what the adversary controls, this is what the honest guys are, then this like if we start counting 1, 2, 3 and so on, this would be the number of messages that he can send. Okay? Okay, it's easy to see that if we have such a broadcast, then we can have an unpredictable beacon by simply asking everybody to broadcast a random nonce, right? And then hashing everything. Okay. So as I said, beacons should be just unpredictable. The adversary can influence it. In particular, he can choose his randomness after he saw the randomness of these guys. But if we model this H as a random oracle, then his influence is limited. And in particular, he cannot make it equal to the value that he's chosen. Okay, so it would be like a good genesis block, for example. It suffices, of course, for the security at least one of those R's was chosen randomly. It's also easy to say, to show that if we have this POW-based broadcast, then we can create PKI. So simply, everybody creates in his head public key, private key pair, and broadcasts the public key. Okay? Then Well, everybody will receive the same because it's a broadcast protocol, so the party can be identified by its public key. Okay? So as a result, everybody will agree on a set Y of n parties that participate in the protocol, and we will know that every honest party controls one public key, and the number of parties that are controlled by the adversary, so the adversary knows a corresponding secret key, is bounded by this number, so ceiling from PA, P sub A divided by pi, pi sub A divided by pi, from the properties of the broadcast protocol. Okay, so this means that if you have this POW-based broadcast, then we can compute any secure functionality because we already have PKI, and in case the number of these guys controlled by the adversaries is smaller than M, where M is the number of honest parties, then we can compute any secure functionality with guaranteed output delivery. And well, if we forget about the ceiling here, so if we assume this is a natural number, then this becomes P sub A divided by P has to be smaller than M, the number of honest parties. So if we multiply by pi both sides, we have that pi sub A, so this is the hash rate of the adversary, has to be smaller than M times pi, so this is the total hash rate of the honest guys. Okay? So this is exactly the assumption that the majority of computing power is honest. Okay? So this this is what I was telling before, that in case we control the majority of computing power, we can compute any functionality. Okay, so basically the whole thing is like how to construct this POW-based broadcast. Again, it was a protocol that allows everybody to send a message, but the number of messages that are sent, that are broadcast, should correspond somehow to his computing power. Okay? So if the adversary controls 10 times the computing power, the hash rate of a normal guy, then he should be able to send 10 times more messages, okay? Or 10 messages, simply because we assume that everybody sends one message. Okay, so how to construct such a protocol, and unfortunately there is no time to present the protocol in detail, but let me just tell you what is the main problem. So the main problem is that we have to address is that proof of work, so suppose we have a proof of work, okay, that requires some work T in terms of the calls to hash function, and consider the following protocol for sending a message. So suppose there is a receiver here and he wants to receive a message with the proof so that he is not, say, flooded by a large number of messages. Okay? So everybody with the message who wants to send a message attaches a proof of work to compute it on this message M. Okay? So that was one of the original applications of the proof of work to prevent spam. Okay? So the problem is that this protocol doesn't make much sense the way I wrote it, because even a sender with a very small hash rate can send a lot of messages to the receiver if he starts to work very early, right? He can pre-compute the solutions very early. If M's are not fresh, he can start computing now, and in a month he will have a lot of solutions, and then he can start sending. Okay? So that's not what we need. We need that these messages are fresh, and of course this can be, in a two-party case, it can be done very easily. So just send a random challenge R when wait time delta. So this is the time, this unit of time that we defined earlier. And then the proof of work has to be computed on M and R, right? So this is a very simple observation, and it's a simple solution in the two-party case. And it's easy to see that in this protocol, the sender with hash rate T can send at most one message. The problem is how to do it in a multi-party case, okay? So a natural idea is to ask every player to send a random, to broadcast via insecure broadcast some random nonce. Okay. And then to securely broadcast a message, each party M would compute POW on H together with R1, R2, R3, and so on. Okay. So every party PI would accept only if this POW is correct on everything and his nonce is in the set. Okay. So I'm receiving messages from all of you. All these R's, I'm concatenating it with my M, I'm computing hash on it, and I'm sending it back, and each of you believes that this proof of work is fresh if his nonce is there. Okay. But then for a broadcast, and then it's easy to see that it will work, but the problem is that for the broadcast, it doesn't really work because, say, what if the adversary ignores R2.
Okay.
So if the adversary ignores the nouns coming from this guy P2, then this two will accept and this one will reject because his R2 is not there. Okay. So there is a problem because we need consistency for broadcast. Okay. So at the end, our construction is not that simple. And we needed to work it requires several rounds. Whereas our solution is, and there is no time to show it, I'll just tell you what are our methods. So we construct a weaker primitive called ranked keys that assigns a rank to every key, so describes the quality of the key from the point of view. And then we combine it with the classical Dolek strong authenticated broadcast protocol. And then we also take into account some this annoying facts that, well, the communication takes time, so we take it into account. And the second thing is that the verification of puzzles takes time, okay? So even in very simple proof of work, well, the work done by the prover is much longer than the work done by the verifier, but still the verifier does some negligible work. And this means that if you need to be careful.